Have you ever been at that place in your life where you've thought to yourself, what's next? For all intents and purposes, my life as a mom with two young kids and an adoring husband was great. So when I received the text that threatened to change my daily existence, even I was surprised at how quickly I jumped at the chance. It all began in the summer of 2010 when my Olympic swim coach texted me from the U.S. Swimming National Championships. Have you seen the winning time in the women's 800-meter freestyle? He asked. It was nearly 15 seconds slower than the world record you set in 1989. Yeah, coach, and your point is, knowing my coach, there was always a point. Was he inferring that I should swim again? I mean, if he hadn't noticed, it was 22 years later. I was now 38 years old, and I hadn't swum competitively in 15 years. In fact, with the shape I was in, frankly, if I wanted to swim again, I had a long road ahead of me. 20 years earlier, I'd had an illustrious career as an Olympic swimmer. At the age of 17, I'd showed up bright-eyed at the 1988 Seoul Olympics, ready to defend the United States against the infamous and very powerful East German women's swim team. Now, these Olympics were a really big deal. It was the first Olympics since 1976 that the Western world had competed in swimming against the Eastern Bloc. At those 1976 Montreal Olympics, the East German women won 11 of 13 gold medals. The U.S. just won. Besides my coach, and of course my parents, they were the only people that thought I stood a chance against the East Germans. One of the reasons was the East German's size. The average East German swimmer was 5'10", weighed about 180 pounds. Me, at the time, I was 5'2", and weighed 99 pounds soaking wet. Back then, I just loved to swim. I thrived on competition, and I thrived on going to practices every day. And since the Seoul Olympics were my first games, the only pressure I really felt was simply to do my best. And if I didn't win, hey, it didn't matter. I'd just go back home, start my senior year of high school. But don't get me wrong, I was a competitor, and I wanted to win. It's just that I'd never really thought about what would come after winning one of those illustrious Olympic gold medals. My first race, I was as surprised as anyone when I won. And my second race, I was just as surprised. But I remember touching the wall at the end of my third race and feeling relief. Relief that I had gone 3 for 3 at the Olympic Games. In the span of less than a week, I'd gone from a good swimmer who loved to compete to a young woman who had single-handedly defeated the East Germans. Thank you. But after winning those medals, I felt a tremendous amount of pressure to compete at a world-class level every single time I jumped into the swimming pool. Suddenly, if I didn't break a world record or win a race by 10 seconds, I would feel like I had completely failed. After high school, I took a scholarship to a prestigious university where my new swim coach decided that he was going to make me into an even better Olympian, whatever that means. He decided to immediately up my double workouts, two practices a day, to triple workouts, 3 practices a day, I was logging about 8 hours in the pool every day. Between a full class load and my obviously crazy swimming schedule, I was emotionally and physically exhausted. Swimming had become a chore, and I was miserable, just miserable. So miserable that training for the 1992 Olympic Games in Barcelona became an end game for me. I wanted to get to Spain to win, which of course I had to, but also to finish so I could quit the sport and get on with my life. My first race in Barcelona was the 400 freestyle. I was the defending Olympic champion, the current world record holder, and I hadn't lost the race on the international stage in nearly 6 years. And I lost. By less than 2/10 of a second, the blink of an eye. I was devastated. To me, an Olympic silver medal was a complete tragedy. It was so bad that to this day, I have yet to watch that entire race on video. A few days later, I swam the 800 meter freestyle, and I defended my Olympic title. But by then, the joy was completely gone. As expected, I quit the sport, until my coach coaxed me back into the pool a few months later. Reluctantly, I agreed to train for the 1996 Olympics in Atlanta. For me, the highlight of those games was passing the torch to Muhammad Ali at the opening ceremonies. But I failed to medal in either of my races. However, I left Atlanta with a sense of optimism. I was a newly retired athlete who could define my career in a nice little package with multiple Olympic medals and the honor of passing that torch to Ali. And as time passed, retirement brought me a sense of relief. I stopped fixating on the sport of swimming, and I began to simply live. Live the life I'd imagined for so long. I graduated from college, I got married, I had 2 beautiful children, and I simply lived my life. But I was never quite satisfied with the way my Olympic career ended. I had that what-if feeling. What if I could go back to the pool and swim with the joy and the passion that I had so clearly lost in 1992 and 1996? So that's why, when I received that text from my coach, his words struck a nerve. I was actually walking on the beach with my husband and young children when the text came in, and I pondered it for a while. I looked at it, and I finally looked up at my husband, who's not really a swimmer, and I said, I think I'm gonna swim again. And he said, great, awesome, I'll grab my fins so I can keep up with you, and we'll get to the pool, and we'll just swim. We'll get in the best shape, Janet. We'll get in the best shape. And I said, no, honey, not your kind of swimming. My kind of swimming. He looked at me like I was a little crazy, and then he said, why? And I said, because I have to. Believe it or not, the next morning, I got out of bed and went to the swimming pool. Okay? Now consider this. Since the 1996 Olympics, I had not trained competitively. Sure, I'd gotten in a couple times when I was pregnant with my kids to stay fit, but I hadn't swam. And I'd forgotten how cold a swimming pool is at 5:30 in the morning. And to make it even more painful, once I got in that pool, I was being lapped by 15-year-olds. I was mortified. Why in the world had I agreed to this? I truly thought I was losing my mind and couldn't figure out why I was there. After practice, I beelined over to my coach and I said, comeback's over before it's begun. I quit. And besides, my husband and my kids, well, they need me. My coach said, Janet, do you know how to ski? No, coach, I swim. Okay, well, when you learn how to ski, you don't look all the way at the bottom of the mountain. You ski 5 feet ahead of you in all times. Take this comeback foot by foot. And besides, the Olympic trials, they're nearly 2 years away. So believe it or not, once again, the next morning, there I was, back at the pool. And before I knew it, 6 months had passed. And those lightning-fast teenagers who made me question my sanity, well, they didn't seem so fast anymore. I could actually keep up with them. And on a good day, I could even beat them. I started to look forward to my daily six-hour training session with these teens. They never judged. They just inspired me with their love and support and encouragement. In fact, my whole life was bookended with love and support. My husband was a rock star, taking care of the kids while I was at the pool and also working full time. As a soon-to-be 40-year-old woman, I had never felt more empowered. I was swimming times close to the times I swam in my early 20s. And the best part of it was, when I laid my head on the pillow every night, I felt an incredible sense of satisfaction. Something I truly never felt before. This comeback was for me and no one else. And you know what happened? I found the joy again. The joy I hadn't had since my teens. I was happy. Things were good. And in the summer of 2012, I swam a 800-meter freestyle in 8 minutes and 46 seconds, only 10 seconds slower than the time I swam at the 1996 Atlanta Olympics. This time qualified me to swim at the 2012 Olympic trials in Omaha. So with my husband, parents, and kids in tow, we made the trip to Nebraska. And before I knew it, it was time to swim. It was an average qualifying heat, a preliminary race, meant to determine the fastest 8 swimmers for that evening's final. As I walked out to take my place behind the blocks and put on my cap and goggles, I noticed a sense of change in the crowd. So I looked up, and there before me stood 10,000 fans who spontaneously started cheering and applauding and chanting my name. I had never seen it coming. And as my heart filled with gratitude, my eyes filled with tears. Despite my efforts, I didn't make the 2012 Olympic team. And while it was disappointing, I wasn't devastated like I would have been so many years beforehand. For the first time since I was a teenager, I didn't care what anyone else thought. I had finally pushed past the need to please, to win, to prove to the world and myself that I was good enough. This comeback was for me to finally close a door that I'd never really shut in the way I wanted to. As I reflect on this journey, I realize that sometimes in life, we have to travel far beyond our true selves to really discover who we are. For me, after I won my medals, I lost sight of me. But when I came back, I found out what I was made of. I discovered that life isn't about doing one thing on a grand scale and then being done. It's about testing ourselves every decade in new and glorious ways. And if the critics call you crazy, well, I say you're on the right track. And so I learned that a tipping point only profoundly happens when we have the courage to trust our gut and live our life as is no one else is looking. It doesn't matter what path you take to reconnect with yourself, as long as you are willing to take that first step. Thank you.